Glory to God. Well, I feel blessed today. I am going to bring you Genesis to Revelation in this message. So hold on to your seats. And as my voice holds up, that's a faith statement. We're going to talk about the seed of the woman. And I've done this many times in the past, but I'm doing it again. I haven't done it in a few years, so some of you have not heard this before. So what we're going to do is look at what the Bible's all about, what God has done, and what we're seeing when we read through the Bible, and what we're seeing in society today. And so is everybody ready? And there will be no scriptures. Please don't even bother with the scriptures, because that will distract you if you look at the scriptures, because I'm going to talk as fast as I can, like maybe 600 miles a minute, right, or something, 600 words per minute, and so we can get through this in a prolonged, in a short period of time, because there's food on the table, amen? So this is interesting, so praise the Lord. All right, Father, we just thank you that we have attention, we have our ears on, and Lord, that we're able to process rapidly and that you're going to bring us all into a new understanding of what you did in Jesus' birth. In Jesus' name, amen. 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 All right, in Genesis 2, 7 through 8, the Bible tells us that God created a new creation on the earth, a human being. A human being. Do you know how special you are? You're a human being. You're not dogs, cats, horses, fish. No, you're a human being. And with that came very, very special equipment. All this human being, this man, we'll say man, in this man, in creation, dwelt all of the glory that was of God. He was clothed with the very Shekinah glory of God in the Garden of Eden. He was the image of God. And as he dwelt alone in Genesis 2, 21 through 23, God saw that he was alone, and that wasn't very good. And so he made a woman from his side as a helper that was supposed to support and help him. They were fit together perfectly as God made them to fit. And her name was Eve. That meant mother of all living. Now Adam and Eve had an enemy, and his name was Lucifer. We may know him better as the devil. He slipped into Eden, this ideal paradise that God had made for Adam and Eve alone, and he gave them a choice that was based on a deceptive lie. He took God's word to them and twisted it in an attempt to frustrate God's original plan. Thus, he cheated, outwitted, and deceived Eve. Now, after Lucifer's plan was uncovered, God cursed him. In Genesis 3:15, we see that God said, "I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your seed and her seed. And he shall bruise and tread your head underfoot, and you will lie in wait and bruise his heel." Since God has said everything he's going to do, before he ever does it, he said it in his word and through his prophets. He made no secret of his intentions here with Lucifer. He has told him where. He has told him in what manner the seed spoken of there in Genesis 3:15 was to come. And then all creation began to wait for God's plan and purpose to come to pass. And so men have looked forward to the coming of the Messiah, the great deliverer, from the time of Adam through the time of Jesus Christ. And once Jesus came, bringing new life to mankind at the cross, Calvary, then those of us who are recipients of this new life look back to his life. Before the cross, they looked forward. Now we look back to the cross. So there was a time warp. Can we call it a time warp? All right. And this that I'm going to tell you today is a special story that actually encompasses a lot of stories. And it's a story of how the devil tried to keep the seed of the woman from coming to bruise his head. A story of the devil's self-defense mode. when he was trying to keep his kingdom together. Now, we already said that God gave the devil all the information on Jesus, hundreds, even thousands of years before Jesus was to come. And so this first mention of the seed in Genesis 3:15, God told about this one that was to come. He told through the prophets what tribe, what nation, what family. Now, that's giving them your address, right? I mean, that's really telling everything. He told them when, told him how he was going to be born of a virgin. He made knowledge through the prophets that the city of his birth was going to be Bethlehem of Judea and how he would die. And the prophet Isaiah spoke these words in Isaiah 55:11. He said, "So shall my word be that goes forth from my mouth. It shall not return to me void, but it shall accomplish what I please. It shall prosper in the thing for which I sent it." So Lucifer, he mounted a campaign to pervert and stop the word of God from coming to pass. If he could just do that, he thought, he could pronounce himself as almighty and demand the worship that was due to God. That was the reason, wasn't it, that he fell from his heavenly estate. Therefore, the story that is seen throughout the ages that follow simply revolves around Lucifer trying to kill the seed of the woman. That is what your entire Bible is about. Before, during, and after. In fact, there was a time that he actually did kill the seed of the woman, didn't he? And in 1 Corinthians 2:8, the Word of God tells us that had he known exactly what he was doing, he would have never tried to kill him. Because as Lucifer attempted to kill Jesus, Jesus laid down his life and bruised the head of the serpent, ascending to God's only, according to God's only and original plan. So this happened in the fullness of time that God had prophesied. So we see it's a very concise matter. What we're dealing with today in this world is the same. Jesus has died, but the church has now got the mark on their back that the devil is still trying to destroy the church, the body of Christ. All right, after the fall, Adam renamed Eve, the woman, Eve, and she brought forth her first children, the twins, Cain and Abel. Now, you're going to say, twins? Well, the Word of God states that Adam knew his wife, and she conceived and brought forth. It doesn't say that he knew her twice. And if you'll read through your Bible, every time there's conception, that's an important conception, God will say, they conceived, they each had a single child. This time they conceived, there were two babies. So we would say that is two children, right? Cain and Abel. And they were brothers of the closest degree. And in time, the devil stirred up a jealousy in Cain, and he slew his brother, Abel. Cain had brought an offering of God that he had wrought out of the ground that God cursed. And God rejected the first fruit of the crop harvested by his own ability. Because God does not receive works as pure sacrifice. Abel pleased God by bringing a little lamb as God required as the blood sacrifice. Now, when Adam and Eve came out of the garden, they were well acquainted with the need for a sacrifice because of their experience with God. Both of these young men knew by being taught by their parents that God had slain innocent animals and put their bloody skins over their parents to cover their nakedness after the fall. The devil was there at that place of sacrifice, and he began to pour out his venom and his hatred upon the seed of the woman. Now, in Genesis 3:16, God said to the woman in the garden, "I will greatly multiply your grief and your suffering in childbearing." Not only did this mean that the woman would have pain in labor and delivery, but also that the bearing of children and the attack of the enemy upon them would bring forth greater grief and suffering of loss for many women. Here Eve sees her firstborn children gone from her in one day, boom, because Cain rose up and slew his brother Abel out of jealousy, and the evil of his heart. Cain was then cursed by God as an outcast and a fugitive upon the face of the earth, and the enemy had struck, bah, the first of the seed of the woman, because he believed that if he could kill the seed of the woman, he would keep the ancient prophecy from coming to pass. Then he would be God, and all creation would have to recognize and worship him. It was here that he began his attack. In Matthew 1:3, the genealogy of the lineage of Judah reveals that the third son that Eve bore was named Seth. Seth was the chosen seed, whereby the lineage was preserved that the promised seed came through. God outwitted the devil at the very first attack. Now keep that in mind. Abraham, we move on to Abraham. Abraham took to wife Sarah. And the first name Sarai had been changed by God to mean mother of all nations, Sarah. So she had waited many years for the promise of a son. She had been barren, and she knew that God, what God had promised and the importance of the birthright and the lineage. Now you may wonder why there's so many genealogies in the Bible, and how boring all those genealogies in the Bible are. But those genealogies are there because the seed of the woman is tracked through all of those genealogies to the birth of Christ. If we can but see it and track it. However, in despair, she gave up, Sarah gave up, and she gave her handmaiden to Abraham to bring forth what she thought she was be the seed. They're always trying to help God, aren't we? Just give God a little help here. And when she gave Hagar to Abraham, Ishmael was born. Now, shortly after Ishmael's birth, Sarah then became pregnant on her own and bore Isaac, who was the son of the promise, or the one through whom the seed would come. Now, Ishmael was stirred up by the enemy, the devil, in jealousy against Isaac. Because after all, it worked with Cain and Abel, right? If it's working, keep it working, right? Jealousy. So Sarah was wise in what she commanded. She commanded Abraham to remove the slave woman and her son from the family unit. And Abraham held back, but God undertook on Sarah's behalf, commanding Abraham to turn out the bondwoman and her son because the promised seed would come through Isaac, and he did not want Ishmael to murder Isaac. Amen? So the birthright has a great importance in the scriptures because it was the firstborn that received the inheritance, except in certain cases where it was set apart by God. Years later in the life of Isaac, a young woman came into another country and came out to draw water at a well. And this woman was destined to be in the lineage of Jesus Christ. The man who had come here to her place to find a wife for his master, Isaac. He found her amidst and watering the camels, as he had been told. He took Rebekah back to Isaac, and she became his bride. And from this union of Isaac and Rebekah came another set of twins. Let me hear that, twins. Esau and Jacob. Now, Esau had no interest in his birthright, and he sold it to his brother Jacob for a pot of stew. Esau was totally carnal. He was a totally fleshly man, carnal man. And nothing of the Spirit quickened him towards the birthright. He had no interest in it, no drawing to it. And therefore Jacob, whose very name meant supplanter or usurper, or we might call it a con man, prevailed by trading stew for the birthright. Esau threatened to kill Jacob after Esau died because he realized that he had done something that he wasn't quite sure he wanted to do. Jacob had robbed him of the blessing at the deathbed of their father again, and Esau hated him all the more, wanting to kill him, stirring up this jealousy, wasn't it? And Jacob's mother intervened and sent him to Mesopotamia to his uncle Laban. Get him out of Dodge, right? Laban was her brother. Now, Rebecca sent him there to save his life and to get a wife. Kind of rhymes, doesn't it? Save his life and get a wife. Some people say, get a life, but he was to go get a wife out of his own people rather than a wife from the heathen lands around where they dwelt. So Jacob fell in love with Laban's daughter Rachel, the younger sister of Leah. And when Uncle Laban tricked him into marrying Leah first, the con man got conned and the tricker got tricked. I can't imagine how he didn't even recognize that till the next morning. Pretty amazing. The lineage of Jesus reveals that the unloved Leah, the one who was hated by her own sister, the one that bore her children in rejection from her husband, and she brought forth the son Judah. And it is here that God sets up a whole tribe to bring forth the Messiah. Judah was the fourth son of Leah, born to Jacob. Judah was one of the 12 tribes of Israel. King David came from the tribe of Judah, and David's own greater son, Jesus, came through that lineage. Jesus came as a lion of the tribe of Judah. Genesis 29:35 reveals that the name Judah means praise. Over 500 New Old Testament references reveal that praise is set forth to undo the works of the devil. So there was no better name for this tribe than Judah. The enemy has sought to bring division and death to the lineage, but God had prevailed right there by broadening the base of choices. Isaac, then we had Jacob and Esau, then we had 12. Think about it. Wow. 12 tribes, 12 choices. Now there was a woman in Genesis 38, 6 through 7, whose name was Tamar. The scripture didn't tell where she came from or who her family was. But it does say that Judah chose her to become a wife for his older son, Ur. And the scripture says, now Judah took a wife for Ur, his firstborn, and her name was Tamar. Ur was evil, and he was wickedly inspired by the devil, who continued to stir up rebellion and wickedness in the family chosen by God. Ur was wicked in the sight of God, and God slew him. Took care of that, right? All right. Judah told Onan, the second son, that he was to marry his brother's widow, live with her, and raise up an offspring for his brother Ur because of the birthright. Now, in the Eastern tribal culture, when a woman's husband died and she had no children, the next brother was to marry her, giving her children that she would raise up in as her first husband's children. Now, in Genesis 38, 9 through 10, we see that Onan knew that the seed would not be his, the child would not be his. And it came to pass that when he went into his brother's wife, he spilled the seed on the ground, lest he should give seed or a child for his brother. And the thing displeased God, and God slew him. Now the tribe of Judah was narrowed down to one person. Boom. And no offspring except for a young son named Shelah, who was the third son of Judah. Now Judah told Tamar that she should remain a widow at her father's house until Shelah was grown, and then perhaps, he would give him to her as a husband. Now Judah really had no intention of giving this last son, because he'd already lost two sons with this woman. So he thought that was a bad sign. And he was afraid he was going to lose his last son. But because Shelah was the only son Judah had left, God was going to preserve his life. Not only did his father want to preserve his life, but God wanted to preserve his life. So Tamar abode among the tribe of Judah, under Judah's covering, but he didn't see her anymore after that, nor did he give her as a wife to the youngest son when he became grown. Now, as the story goes on, Tamar knew that Judah owed her a son. and that he was not being righteous before God. The seed would die out right there because Judah did not have any interest in preserving the lineage. Now the Spirit of God stirred up Tamar, and she put off her respectability by putting on the disguise of a harlot. And she met Judah out on the roadside and seduced him. And he had intercourse with her, and she became pregnant. Before he left her, she demanded that he give her a token pledge of their relationship because he promised to send her a small lamb in return for her favor. I say prostitution has been around for years. Judah gave her, I think this man had a lapse of his brain. He gave her his staff and his signet ring. He didn't even know her name. These things linked her directly to him because she had the symbols of his authority. So Judah went home, and after a few days passed, he sent a lamb back with one of his friends because he promised a lamb, and they couldn't find the woman. So they brought the lamb back to Judah. 3 months later, then, when Tamar's pregnancy began to show, Judah cursed her and brought her out to have her burned to death as a harlot. But Tamar came out with, ta-da, the signet ring and the staff, the symbols of his authority. God convicted him, would you say, right there? Oh, my. And he admitted that he was indeed not a righteous man, but that Tamar herself was more righteous in what she had done because he would not give her the youngest son that he was legally bound to do. So God had intervened in a very unusual way, wouldn't you say? Have you ever found out that he doesn't do things your way or my way? He has his own way here. Isaiah, the prophet, says that God's work is strange. He calls it his strange act. He doesn't do things like man would do things, but he does get them done according to the law. Tamar risked her life, and she bore, let me hear it, twins. More twins in there. More twins. Perez, the older son, was the one whom the seed would come through. God used Tamar to frustrate the plan of the devil by giving her a burning desire for a child of the seed that would bring forth the seed of the woman. Now, Jacob had another son. His name was Joseph. Now, Joseph was hated by his brothers because the enemy had again stirred up an age-old family enmity through jealousy. His brothers tried to kill him, but decided to sell him into slavery instead. Makes sense. Joseph went into the land of Egypt as a slave, and there, in obedience to God, he turned aside the wicked wills of Potiphar's wife, took his time in the jailhouse, and became strong in God. The scripture says that God put a rod of iron in his back in the time that he was in the jail. And then there came a famine into the land, and God elevated him to become overseer of all the land of Egypt and of all the food of Egypt. Now, when the famine was great in the land where Jacob's offspring lived, and the tribes were threatened with extinction through total starvation, there was one in Egypt with the food that God had set forth for them. Joseph invited all of his brothers, and they all went down to Egypt and dwelt there. And this was purposed for the preservation of the 12 tribes of Israel that were born to Jacob. How God works. Now, before Jacob died, in Genesis 49:10, he prophesied over all of his sons, saying that the scepter should not depart from Judah until Shiloh should come. Shiloh is another name for Jesus Christ. This meant that the power and the authority would not depart from the lineage of the tribe of Judah until the time that Jesus Christ would be made evident, the time when the seed of the woman destined to bruise the head of the serpent would be brought forth. Now, after the people of God spent 400 years of servitude in Egypt. The enemy stirred up Pharaoh to kill all the male offspring of Israel. During this time of carnage and destruction in Egypt, Jochebed, a daughter of Levi, had a baby boy. Anne saw something special in that baby. God stirred up her heart to hide this baby and nourish him until he became too old to hide. And then she made a little what? Yeah, a little basket, a little boat. And she put this baby in the boat and she pushed him off into the Nile River into the arms of God. Crocodiles could have eaten that baby easy. If the wrong person found the baby would have been killed because the baby was a Hebrew child destined to be murdered according to Pharaoh's decree. But the baby boy floated down the Nile and got stuck in the bulrushes. And he was found by Pharaoh's own daughter. Now God hid Moses in the very house of Pharaoh where he was raised by Pharaoh's daughter. Moses was saved by the intervention of the hand of God. He would deliver the people out of Egyptian bondage so that the seed of the woman would multiply in the land of promise. Now, 80 years later, after this, the children of Israel came out of Egypt. The enemy tried to kill them over and over and over again. There was rebellion in the camp. And the devil stirred up jealousies with hatred and lustful longings within the people who fought with each other while wanting to return to Egypt. I mean, there was a mess out there in the wilderness. The enemy came at them with everything that he had to stir up strife. All of the evil things that were in them began to overpower them. And so they spent 40 years out there in the wilderness before Joshua brought them into the promised land of Canaan. Now, after the death of Joshua, the people of Israel lapsed into a time of tremendous darkness. During the time of Judges, God raised up judge after judge to intervene, but the lineage of Judah would not be saved. They were destined. They had destined themselves to do what they wanted to do. What is it in the period of Judges? It said that every man did what was right in his own eyes. Now they were all self-made men. During this period of time, God raised up these judges and he tried to save them from going extinct. And during this period of time, there was a Moabite woman. Now a Moabite was not a Hebrew. She was a Gentile out of Moab. Her name was Ruth. How many read about Ruth? All right. She came into Bethlehem of Judea with her mother-in-law, Naomi, who was of the tribe of Judah. Imagine that. She came to Bethlehem of Judea, and then Naomi returned from Moab. She came with nothing. Her husband died. Her two sons died. She had two foreigners for daughter-in-laws. She had nothing. And she came back into the land. And after hundreds of years, this was a confirmation by the word of God about the coming forth of the seed. God preserved the tribe of Judah by using Ruth, a Gentile, to indicate that salvation would come through the tribe of Judah. Now, Naomi sent Ruth out in to glean the fields of Boaz to get them some food because they had nothing. And Boaz was a nearer kinsman to her family, which meant that he was of the tribe of Judah. And he was one of the closest ones to her. We're talking about the raising up of the seed and the inheritance where one dies. We talked about that. All right. So Boaz was destined by God to be their kinsman redeemer and married Ruth. Now Ruth in Ruth 4:12, prophecy was given to Boaz and to Ruth by the elders of the people at the gate of the city at their marriage. And it said, let your house be like the house of Perez, whom Tamar bore to Judah, because of the offspring which the Lord will give you by this young woman. And so we see something going on. God is indicating that salvation will come to the Jew and the Gentile. That's where we see it being opened up. Now, Ruth's great-grandson was King David. The devil sought to murder David and destroy the lineage of the seed in many, many ways. First, there was the giant Goliath. And then the Philistine terrorists were after him. And then after that, King Saul chased David for 14 years, wanting to kill him. And then Absalom tried to kill his own father by leading a revolt against him. And there were, during this period of time, famines and wars and fighting. And then there was David's sin of adultery, his murder of Bathsheba's husband, and his numbering of the children of Israel in direct disregard to what God had spoken to him. But, since there are always a but God, there's always a but here, a but. It sounds useless, it sounds hopeless, doesn't it? But because he confessed his guilt before God in repentance, he was called a man after God's own heart. He was quick when he saw it, and he repented. Therefore, God forgave him and preserved the lineage. Now, David had a son named Solomon, who was the one that God would use to preserve that line. Nathan the prophet came to Bathsheba as King David was dying, asking her to confirm to David that he needed to raise up Solomon and anoint him as king because Adonijah, the son of Haggith, had begun to reign instead of David. As he did so from his deathbed, David averted a takeover of the royal lineage because the scriptures said that the scepter would not depart from the tribe of Judah until Shiloh came. Throughout the books of Kings and Chronicles, there are repeated attacks on the seed of David, the lineage of the royal seed. Now in 2 Chronicles 21:3, it's recorded that King Jehoshaphat had 7 sons, and to 6 of them he gave great gifts of silver and gold. But to the 7th son, he gave the authority for the kingdom. When Jehoshaphat died, his son, whose name was Jehoram, killed his other 6 brothers and all the other princes and nieces and nephews that he could get his hands on. He murdered every man in the lineage to ensure that he would be the only one left alive. He did this as a direct act of defiance towards God, to ensure that if anything happened to his sons, the line would be totally wiped out. Jehoram was a wicked man, and he married wicked King Ahab's daughter, Athaliah, because he admired King Ahab, who did evil things in Israel during his reign, causing Israel to go after all kinds of other gods, according to 2 Chronicles 21:5 through 20. Now Jehoram imitated and began to live like Ahab. God spoke through a word of prophecy telling Jehoram he would destroy him if he didn't change his ways. Then the Philistines, accompanied by the companies of Arabians, destroyed Jehoram, murdering and ravaging his line except for one child. We were back to one, right? Jehoahaz was his name. He also was referred to as Azariah. Jehoahaz was wicked like his father and reigned 1 year before he was killed by Jehu. This left the wicked, perverted Queen Athaliah in charge of the tribe of Judah. She killed all of her grandchildren, the whole lineage of the royal seed, as far as she knew, in a great carnage, killing hundreds, young and old. However, King Jehoram had a sister. She was raised in the same household, but she had a heart for the things of God. Her name was Jehosheba, meaning Jehovah is the oath. She had married the high priest, Jehoiada, and when this carnage happened, God stirred her up, and she ran to the palace where all the murders had taken place. She ran into the room with total disregard for her own life, and because if Athaliah had been there or found that she was there, she would have been, had her murdered. Athaliah was killing everybody because she was going to be the only queen and the only ruler in Judah. Jehoshaphat found a one-year-old child lying under the bodies in the palace. She took the baby boy, Joash, to her own house where she and her husband hid him for 6 years from Queen Athaliah as he grew and was nurtured in the ways of God. Joash was the only surviving infant son of Azariah. At the end of 6 years, when this young man was seven, the high priest brought Joash out to the people to set him up as king over Judah. He was the only seed that survived. When they brought him out, no one knew of the existence of this child, and the people began praising God for a king that was anointed of God. When Queen Athaliah heard this and the noise, she came into the temple and she ordered that child to be killed. And the people, we the people rallied. They rallied. They ran and they protected this child. And they grabbed her and they took her out into the street and they killed her. Again, ta-da, the seed was preserved, and Satan had been defeated. Now, King Ahaz was even more wicked and perverted than King Ahab, 2 Chronicles 28, and he closed the temple, and he set up idols in every high place to be worshipped. He would kill people for worshipping the true God. King Ahab was so perverted that he absolutely was close to God, but God sent him a sign anyway. He sent him a sign through the prophet Isaiah saying, "The Lord himself shall give you a sign." Well, he'd never even asked for a sign. But God sent him a sign. He said, "Behold, a virgin shall conceive and shall bear a son and call his name Emmanuel." That's Isaiah 7:14. 700 years later, the angel Gabriel came to a virgin. The angel told her that she was blessed among women because the Holy Spirit would overshadow her and she would bring forth a sinless child, the one that was born to bruise the head of the serpent as spoken of in Genesis 3:15. This was in the fullness of time, that it might be fulfilled as the prophets spoke by the Holy Spirit. God had laid out a plan over the ages, and the enemy tried to destroy that plan. And many have asked, and you probably have too, why were there so many wars? Why were there so many battles? How come many people got killed? So many people were getting killed everywhere. What kind of a God of peace is this? Well, this is definitely the battle of the ages, the battle between Satan and God Almighty. This is the battle that's going on today. Don't be fooled. Today, this is the battle. Don't think your Bible is not pertinent to today. Don't listen to anybody that says it's not pertinent today. It's still the same war, isn't it? The battle between God Almighty and Satan. Now, through all those years, God preserved the lineage and he defeated the devil at every turn. Every battle that was fought was not a battle between personalities or for human power, but it was God's battle with Satan, who continued stirring up men to destroy the coming seed of the woman. Now, Jesus was born of a virgin impregnated with a divine seed. His blood was divine because his father was God. He was the Lamb of God, a sinless offering for mankind's sin of rebellion against God. Mary's lineage was pure all the way through, as listed in Luke 3:23-38. However, Joseph's genealogy, as listed in Matthew 1:1-17, was tainted by an exceedingly wicked king called Jeconiah, or Coniah, in Jeremiah 22:30. The blood that was spilled on Calvary for our salvation was not the blood of a man, but it was the blood of God. Divine and royal blood coming as God said it would from the seed of the woman. And this story is played out throughout your entire Bible. The Word of God is exciting because just as sure as the enemy came into the Garden of Eden and said to Eve, "Hath God not said," as if it never happened, we can say, "Hath God not said that he would bring forth the seed that would bruise the head of the serpent?" The serpent bruised his heel as it was driven through with a nail on the cross. There his heel was bruised, and there he crushed the head of the devil. God's word came to pass. And this story should build faith in what God has spoken. When Jesus was born, it was the culmination of the battle of the ages. His very birth and the way he was hidden by God, sent to safety in Egypt, then brought back to Nazareth when the time was right in all of God's perfect plan. His word today is as sure as it was as when he set forth the succession for the seed from the woman. Eve, through the lineage of the tribe of Judah and down through David's line until Jesus the Christ was born of a virgin in Bethlehem. The word of God brings forth life. When he speaks, his word assuredly will bring forth and bring to pass what it is sent to do. The entire Old Testament is culminated in the birth of Jesus Christ because he is the seed of the woman. This was a triumph, bringing defeat to the devil in God's own way. The devil could never stop it, and he can't stop it now, church. He cannot stop, the devil can't stop it now. He can't stop what's happening. He can't stop what the church is called to do. He cannot stop what you're called to do. God's people were faithful. And as the Spirit of God stirred them up, they risked their lives and their own reputations that they might be where God wanted them to be at the right time. It's no wonder that John the Apostle marveled so at Jesus in John 1:14, and he said, "And the Word, Christ, became flesh, human and incarnate, and tabernacled, fixed his tent of flesh, lived a while among us, and we actually saw his glory, his honor and his majesty, such glory as only begotten Son receives from his Father, full of grace, favor, loving kindness, and truth." And there we have the story of Jesus, the seed of the woman. Very encapsulated. Oh, we skipped 400 years here and 700 years there. Aren't you happy? Praise the Lord. They went by as if nothing happened, because a day with the Lord is as 1,000 years. 1,000 years is just a day. But you can see here, this should build your faith. Like I said, because if God, through all that period of time, will bring that to pass, will he not do what he has said he will do concerning you, your people, your loved ones, your life, and his church? Amen? We don't have to be afraid in this world of anything. We keep our eyes on the Lord, for the Lord, he is God, and besides him, there is none other. So to me, this is the story of the birth of Jesus Christ. This is the reason for the season. This is why the Bible has so much killing going on in it. The devil is a mean devil, but God is greater. He is greater. Let's have communion this morning before we dismiss. And let's celebrate. Let's celebrate the fact that this seed of the woman came and he brought forth for us life and light because of his sacrifice Amen? Amen. Praise the Lord. Let's stand. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. I hope you learned something today. Kind of brings the Bible together for you. And it did for me as I studied it. I'm so appreciative that Jesus was the plan. The plan was the Lamb that would be slain from with the foundation, before the foundation of the world. And here is the plan. God knew it. No man had to help him. And unfortunately, when they tried to, they just complicated things, didn't they? And today we live with a complication of Sarah's wanting to help God. But it is the same God. And he used even Ishmael and his offspring to bring to pass what he needed to bring to pass. So don't think that anything is wasted in God. Nothing that you give God is ever wasted. Your life, your money, your children, your family, your plans, your ambitions, God will bring them back around through death to life. Let's just take a moment and let's think about maybe rededicating our lives to the Lord this morning. Making a fresh commitment for this Christmas. We don't need a New Year's resolution. We need a fresh commitment to Christ, which will bring everything into perspective and work all things for good for those that love him. As we know, God can keep his word. We have nothing to fear. Thank you. A virgin shall conceive and bring forth a son. Isaiah said it and he never saw it from that perspective. We look back to it, we were not there, but we are here because he was there. His body that was broken for us. Let us eat together. By his stripes, we are healed. He was wounded for our transgressions. He bore our iniquities. It's done. Let us drink from the cup that symbolizes the new covenant. His blood that has brought us into new life. Let us drink together. And thank God for the plan. And thank God for the fulfillment of the plan and for the faithfulness of the people and for the power of his word. Amen? So we would say easily today, it's a merry Christmas. It's a merry Christmas because at Christmas was born the seed of the woman. Amen. Praise God, to whom we owe our salvation. Does anyone need prayer this morning before we dismiss? Just come forward if you need prayer. Amen. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Anything special?
Just did something to my hip and loading
this the other day. Oh, my goodness, where? Which hip? This one? Mm-hmm. All right. Okay, Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you that Jesus is our healing. Lord, we thank you that you can release where she may have hurt herself, God. And we thank you that you're just going to relax all those tendons and bring healing right into her hip in the mighty name of Jesus. You are the Lord that heals us. You've proved it over and over again. And so we thank you that this hip will be made every bit whole. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
He sent his word, and he healed them all.
Mm-hmm.
Amen. Praise God. Amen. Praise the Lord. Amen. Praise God. Okay. All right. Okay. Well, stretch your hands towards DC. Her hip and her back is bothering her right now. In the name of Jesus. Lord, we just ask that you would touch her, heal her. And we thank you for it, Lord. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord. You know what I want you to do? I want you to go sit down in that chair right there in the front. Mm-hmm. And I'm going to come to you in just a minute. Sit down. Scoot your back into the back of the chair and get settled in there. We're going to pray for your leg and everything. I'll be right with you. Just sit there prayerfully. Your back? All these backs. Father, in the name of Jesus. Father, in the name of Jesus, we just ask that the oil of the Holy Spirit would just flow down her back, through her spine, tailbone, into the hips. And we thank you for it, Lord, for the healing in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Amen. Praise God. Why don't you sit in that chair, too? Come over and sit in the chair. I'm just getting inspired. Everybody should sit in a chair. All three of you sitting. Anybody else backs problem? Okay. What we're going to do is we're going to pray that God would straighten their legs out and that He'll heal them. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Okay. All right. So I'm going to put your legs out here. Okay. All right. Okay. Let me see this. Okay. See, this foot is small, is shorter than that foot. I mean, this foot is this, right? See that? Okay, all right. So, Father, we just ask in the name of Jesus that you would straighten her leg out, that you would put it back in the right position in the name of Jesus, that it would be however you do it, Lord, just grow it out in Jesus' name and make it every bit whole as it straightens up her back in the name of Jesus. And I thank you, Lord, for doing it. I thank you. Thank you, Jesus. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Okay, praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Praise God. We wait on you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Praise God. All right, I want you to stand up now. Praise the Lord. Because in my eye, it came forward. Did you feel anything?
Yes, I did.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. So now what I'm going to do is find your hips. Okay. Praise the Lord. All right, Father, in the name of Jesus, I just pray you would touch her hips. Not being sacrilegious, but just do the hip thing on her, Lord. Do the hip. Thank you, Jesus. Now, she moves. I'm not moving her. The Holy Spirit is moving her. Are you moving yourself?
No.
Okay.
No.
So, something's happening here. I'm just putting my hands lightly on her hip bones. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. You never know what's going to happen. All right. Thank you. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. All right. Okay, now, how does your back feel?
Normal right now.
It feels normal right
now?
Right
now, yeah.
Okay. Well, we thank you, Lord. It's good?
Yes.
Thank you, Jesus. Father, we thank you. I just pray it stays there. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Not that I don't believe, but thank you, Jesus. Normal, right?
Normal, yeah.
Praise the Lord.
No pain.
No pain.
No, it's okay. Still moving.
You still feel your hips moving?
Yeah.
Well, just stand there and stay in that. Stay right there. Let the Holy Spirit do whatever he's doing. All right, I want to see your feet. Okay, praise the Lord. All right. Thank you, Jesus. All right. Now, I would say that this foot over here, I can't make it, put your ankles together kind of like. Okay, so that is her right foot is short, is longer than her left foot, right? Leg? The foot is longer now. The leg. We're talking about the leg. Okay. All right, so we're going to pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, we just ask that you would straighten her legs. Right now, in the name of Jesus, straighten her legs. Grow whatever one out to match the other one in the name of Jesus. Not that we can do it, Lord, but you can do it. And you've done it before. And I know that you do it, even though it seems unconventional. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. What do you feel?
Right here.
Something's happening, right? Mm-hmm. Something's happening? Okay. And I can't tell, but don't you think they're about the same now? You can see it, sit more so? Okay, stand up. Let's do the hip. Praise the Lord. How does that feel like?
Well,
so far? What happened?
I don't know. It doesn't hurt.
It doesn't hurt?
It just doesn't hurt.
Okay.
I'm good with that.
You're happy with that?
I'm happy with not hurting.
Yeah. Oh, okay. Well, maybe we don't need to do the hip thing.
It feels pretty good now.
Well, you stay right there, and we'll do Robbie, and we'll see if you need the hip thing. Praise the Lord. Okay. Praise God. Hallelujah. This is so fun. Some of you have never seen this before, and we don't do this all the time, but I just felt moved of the Holy Spirit to do it. Father, in the name of Jesus, we just ask that if there's a off in her legs, that you will just straighten them up right now. In Jesus' name. I can't really see with the shoes on, so that's all right. God knows. I'm not doing it anyway. I think this one is shorter than this one, but I can't really see it. But Lord, we just thank you that you're going to straighten her leg out. We thank you for healing her back, stretching, changing, making all things new and normal again in the mighty name of Jesus. And I thank you for it, Lord. I thank you. Praise God. Okay. Stand up and see how it feels.
I could feel it moving.
You could feel it moving?
Mm-hmm.
While you're sitting there?
Yeah.
What did it feel like?
It just seems like it just moved out.
Your leg just moved out? Wow.
Your back feels better.
Okay. It's very interesting.
I
have no clue about this.
Work.
Okay. How's yours?
It's starting to hurt right here again.
Okay. All right. Well, we'll do the hip thing. How about you?
I have a little pain right here, but it's going away.
Okay. All right. Okay. All right. Father, in the name of Jesus, we just lift her to you, and we just ask you would do by the Holy Spirit what needs to be done. We thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Now, are you moving like that? You're not doing it, okay? I just had to ask for everybody else. Thank you, Jesus. Straighten up her back. Fix her hips, make them level, straighten her up in Jesus' name. Take the pain and the cause of the pain in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Oh, there goes some more. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Okay, just stay right there like that.
Do
you want your arms too? Okay, put your hands down. All right. Okay. right, so you want to look at this? See her fingers? Yeah? So there's, it's not the same, is it? Okay. Well, Father, in the name of Jesus, we ask that you would just curl her arm out right now in Jesus' name. Straighten the back. Whoop. Now it's longer than the other one. Now, whoop, now it's coming back. Thank you, Jesus. I heard that pop. Her back popped. All right. Perfect, right? They're straight? Okay. All right. Thank you, Jesus. Stay right there. Okay. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. All right, Father, in the name of Jesus, we just ask that you would take her hips and you would do what needs to be done. Holy Spirit, thank you. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Now, I'm not doing this to you, am I?
I don't think so.
No, I'm not pushing on you.
It doesn't tell me. You're really touching me.
Okay. All right. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Holy Spirit, Holy Spirit. Healing. 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 Whoops, we're going over the other side now. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah.
Oh, wow.
Thank you, Jesus. How's it now? Is it okay?
We're good.
You good?
We're good.
All right. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. All right. Praise God. What happened?
I don't know.
Okay. But praise the Lord.
It's good.
Hallelujah. How about you?
I'm good. It's just a little muscle, you know, the muscle.
Right?
Okay. I feel taller and breathe a little better.
You can breathe better. Father, in the name of Jesus, just soothe the muscles. Let the oil of the Holy Ghost just go over those muscles. In the mighty name of Jesus. Only you can do these things, Lord. Only you can do these things. Praise God. Let's just praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Glory to God. So something happened and it's wonderful. And we don't know how it happened, but God did something great. Praise the Lord. And he's going to do something great for every one of you this Christmas. God is doing good things. Amen?
Yeah.
Amen. Well, Father, we thank you in the name of Jesus that you have done your strange act. You've done differently than we're used to, but Lord, you have touched and healed and relieved pain just like you have brought us, Lord. You brought us a long ways, and we thank you for it in the mighty name of Jesus. And everyone said, amen.
Hi, I'm Pastor George Stover, Wellspring Church of All Nations, right here in Las Vegas, Nevada, 4870 Janelle Drive, 89149, out in the northwest part of town. If you're in Las Vegas, visiting Las Vegas, come see us. You'll be glad that you did. You can look us up on the internet at wellspringlv.org, or you can also order this book, Women in Ministry, that will absolutely clarify any questions that you may have about the place of women in business, in ministry, those kinds of things. Get the resource. It's really worth doing. You can get it at wellspringlv.com, or you can give us a call, 702-631-5027. We'll get a copy out to you right away.